afternoon and good morning to those of you watching online. Glad to see you guys here today. Glad that you were able to join us today. Welcome to the house of the Lord. We seek to worship God and to where we seek to love God and to love one another in God's love as well. So a couple of announcements before we transition to worship. For the teens, we do have the youth program on Saturday. It's at 5:30. And then for younger kids, there is the athletic mentoring program, which is right now for girls is on Tuesdays and Fridays, and it's at 3:30. And then there's potential if boys want to participate, it could be the same times on Mondays and Wednesdays. So if you do want to be a part of that, just mention it to Pastor Steve, and then he'll see what he can do, if he can add you to the group. And then also the Wednesday prayers are at 6 through Zoom. So if you do want to participate in the prayers, you can let Pastor know as well, and then he can send you the invite. The last two things are the Tithely app, which you can donate to Capital Campaigns. You can give your tithes and your offerings in there as well. And then the Bible app, which you can follow along in the sermon. So I believe that's it for announcements. So with that, we're going to transition to worship, and we have a video to do so. Please stand for those who are able to do the call to worship. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Let's all worship the Lord.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, in your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Lord, we come here this morning to worship you and praise you.
Come thou almighty King, help us thy name to sing. Help us to praise, Father all glorious, O'er all victorious, come and reign over us, Ancient of Death. Come thou incarnate world, gird on thy mighty sword. Come and thy people bless, and give thy word success. Spirit of holiness, on us descend. Come, Holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear. In this glad hour, thou who almighty art, now rule in every heart, and from us don't depart, Spirit of power.
Come, thou almighty King.
Father all glorious, O'er all victorious.
keep worshiping the Lord as we sing, "How great is our God." Truly, how great is He.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. El esplendor de un rey, vestido en majestad, la tierra alegre está, la tierra alegre está. Cubierto está de luz, venció la oscuridad. Y tiembla su voz, y tiembla su voz. Cuán grande es Dios, cántale, cuán grande es Dios, y todos lo verán. Cuán grande es Dios. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. You're the name above all names, worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God. Tu nombre sobre todo es, eres ti. How grand is our God? Sing with me, how grand is our God? And all will see how grand is our God.
Please be seated. Now, we don't have ushers because we can't do ushering, per se. So for those who are able, are welcome to use the Tithely app if they're able to help support the church, or we do have the plate for those who are here in person. And if not, that's okay, too. And we're going to shift to the scripture reading.
Today's scripture is found in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. La palabra se encuentra en el libro de Efesios, capítulo 2, versículos 1 al 7. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. En otro tiempo ustedes estaban muertos en sus transgresiones y pecados, en los cuales andaban conforme a los poderes de este mundo. Se conducían según el que gobierna las tinieblas, según el espíritu que ahora ejerce su poder en los que viven en la desobediencia. En ese tiempo también todos nosotros vivíamos como ellos, impulsados por nuestros deseos pecaminosos, siguiendo nuestra propia voluntad y nuestros propósitos, como los demás éramos por naturaleza objeto de la ira de Dios. Pero Dios, que es rico en misericordia, por su gran amor por nosotros, nos dio vida con Cristo, aun cuando estábamos muertos en pecados. Por gracia ustedes han sido salvados, y en unión con Cristo Jesús, Dios nos resucitó y nos hizo sentar con Él en las regiones celestiales, para mostrar en los tiempos venideros la incomparable riqueza de su gracia, que por su bondad derramó sobre nosotros en Cristo Jesús. God, we give you thanks for this word you've given us today, that you allowed us to be here, Lord, to listen to your word. We pray that you open up our ears and we understand the message. Lord, we pray this in your name. Amen.
Well, welcome back. Before we get into week two of our Love Is series, just thought I would ask everyone how last week went. Wondering if people got a chance to practice waiting patiently or being patient with other people. I know my patience started with the service last week, as we couldn't get, we had technical difficulties and had to do some things different. It is amazing how God uses those things, as we found out or recognized after the fact that it's being recorded and in upstreaming it, as opposed to trying to do it live. It actually has less glitches on Sunday. So praise God for that. But being patient is a part of love. And just to get into it, I want to make sure that we understand it's not like, okay, well, last week was patience or waiting patiently, and so, okay, I've got patience down, and now I don't have to worry about that again. So now let's move on. So, Pastor, what's next? So just, you know, as we look at it, we want to recognize that patience is one of those things, and some people find it easier than others, but this is something that should be seen in us. It should be a part of His loving nature that comes through the Holy Spirit. So if this is something that is a struggle for you, patience, then it is something that you want to just continue to ask God to continue to give you strength in this area. Now, we're going to move on to the next one, and that is love being kind. And as I mentioned last week, the words we see in our translations, it looks like love is patient, love is kind, which those are used as adjectives which describe it. Whereas when we look at this in the Greek, all of the words that are being used are actually verbs. And what do we know about verbs? Verbs are action-oriented. So there's an expectation that we're going to be doing something with them. Anthony Thistleton, in his commentary on 1 Corinthians feels a better way to translate this would be love shows kindness rather than love is kind. If we Google kindness, we see that kindness is the quality of being friendly, generous, and considerate. It's often thought of as doing something for someone with no expectation of getting something back in return. Now, it's interesting because it was, I think yesterday I was going through Facebook, it was in the morning, and I happened to see this story of this person who was, this woman had gone to a McDonald's. She was actually out and her kids were not doing the best as far as behaving was going, and she figured maybe they just need something to eat, so she gets to McDonald's, she goes through, she orders what the kids want, and then realizes that she doesn't have her wallet with her and she has no way to pay. And she says, I'm getting ready to, she's like, I can't find my wallet. And before she even goes to ask the person, he pulls out his card and he pays for it for you. And he's like, you're all set. And she's like, no, I'll come back and pay for you. He goes, really, you're all set. And come to find out, she did come back and pay him for it. And she said she actually had to make him take it. But it just meant so much to her that here she was in this crisis situation, in a sense, with their kids, probably trying to avert a meltdown, and here this person was, who didn't know who she was, didn't know anything about her, but stepped in to help her out. So I figured I'd try to look this up, and wouldn't you know, there's so much stuff going on in Facebook, a lot of it is not worthy of looking at. So I'm scrolling down, trying to find it, and I couldn't find it anywhere, because I figured I'd attribute it to someone, but I can't do that. So I figured, well, you know what, let me look it up on Google. So I went in, and there was another case somewhat similar in the UK. In this one, the employee heard the person, this young man was ordering, and as he was ordering, he says, hold on, and he calls his mother, and he says, hey, Mom, I was wondering, do you want anything? I'm at McDonald's, I thought I'd pick you up something. When he got up to pay, he found that the meal was paid for. As the girl said, she was going to pay for his order as her kind act of the day, because he rang his mom and asked her if she wanted anything. She just thought that was thoughtful, and she wanted to encourage that type of behavior. So often, you know, we can think of kindness as starting with a smile, right? That becomes a lot harder. I mean, I look out here, and you may be smiling, you might be frowning, you could be tearing up, and really all I see is a mask. So masks make it much harder to see. But whether we have a mask or not, smiling is helpful, but showing kindness requires action. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen the movie All Saints. It's a movie about a parish that's not making it financially, and they send a new pastor there, and the sole purpose of this pastor is to go. He kind of goes right in, and he's to let them know that basically they're disbanding the church and selling the property. And they'll, you know, find ways to move them into different places. So let's watch a clip from All Saints.
We have welfare, but many new family sleep on floor, not enough food for their children.
Well, maybe one of the bigger churches might be able to...
We are Anglican.
I didn't know Korea had many...
Korean from Burma. We were occupied by the British. We learn about Jesus Christ from the British.
The Anglicans?
Yes, we are Anglican Church, Episcopalian.
Well, here's the thing, Ye Win. All Saints is broke. We're closing the church. We're broke.
What is broke?
Yes, Bishop, I understand that. Oh, of course I do. It's just, until we find a buyer, I think we have an obligation. Oh, come on, it's three Burmese farmers. How much of a drain could it be?
Oh, the bishop's gonna hang me from the steeple.
So I don't know if you get that last comment. He's like, oh, the bishop's gonna hang me from the steeple. So he gets in, and of course he didn't necessarily get the okay, and he figures it's only three Burmese farmers, but there's all their families and everything else that are there. And they're in this place where they're trying to shut everything down, and that's all he's sent there to do. And he knows that going in. His goal is to go and to shut this church down. And here he is now bringing in these families, and they're going to stay there, and there's other things that are involved. He knows the church is preparing to close, but he also knows that he can't turn them away. They've got a building, they've got a facility, they've got this huge plot of land which has good soil, and these farmers who need some place to go. So he allows them to come in, and then as you go along, you see that, well, I'm going to make you watch the movie, so it's interesting. It doesn't quite work out the way that you would think, but it all in the end is pretty good, but it's not quite perfect. I believe it is from a true story that happened. So as we look at these action words that describe love, the perfect example, and these first two that we have, love is, and then from here, we're going to predominantly get into the what love is not. So the first couple really are reflected in Christ. And we see that in today's passage in Ephesians chapter 2. As for you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, and the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us through Jesus Christ. Now, you know, Ephesians 2, you might be saying, Pastor, you missed the best part. You missed the part that we all know, right? For it is grace, by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no man may work. Man may boast, so we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared for us in advance to do. And those are all great things. But what I wanted us to do is to look at this piece of Ephesians chapter 2 that's not always as readily read. And after Paul's introduction and his prayer, he hops right into where we are before Jesus. You were dead in your transgressions and sin in which you used to live. And then he gets in, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature. Basically, what is he saying? He's saying what we would find in Romans, right? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's what we see is basically being stated for. He's just wording it a little bit different. It's like going, you know, you, me, all of us, before Jesus, we're sinners. And we're dead in those sins. And, you know, in that, we're doing the things that make us happy, that we're doing the things that bring us pleasure. But out of that, God steps in. And he doesn't step in because we deserve it. And that's kind of one of the pieces we really want to get out of this. God doesn't step in and go, well, you know what? They really have earned it. They're trying really hard to do what is right. No, he does it because of his great love. He does it because of his mercy. God made us alive in Jesus because of his grace. Grace is just unmerited favor, or it's something that we didn't earn. So it's like we make more mistakes than we do good things, and when God looks at us, he still loves us. He's still passionate about us. So this grace or unmerited favor, it's the church term for getting what we don't deserve. And why did he do this? Well, we see it in verses 6 and 7. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that the coming ages might know or might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. He says, you know, imagine the most amount of money that you could possibly get doesn't even compare with what we get in Jesus. the grace that is offered him, because there's no way that we could ever buy our way. So if we had all the riches of the world, the reality is we couldn't buy our way into heaven. His grace that enables us to be called his children actually over is much greater than that. And Jesus is now in heaven, and he intercedes, or he fights for us. You know, he stands up for us on our behalf. We see this as an expression of God's kindness to us. God offers to us that which we don't deserve, and that's the opportunity to be called his sons and his daughters. Gordon Fee, in his commentary on 1 Corinthians, shares that God's kindness is found in the thousandfold expressions of his mercy. Thus, Paul's description of love begins with this twofold description of God, who through Christ has shown himself forbearing and kind towards those who deserve divine judgment. The obvious implication, of course, is that this is how people are to be towards one another. So he sits there and he looks at us and he goes, we deserve wrath, we deserve punishment, yet God is kind and generous and loving and patient with us. Therefore, we should be kind and generous and patient and loving with those who are around us, whether they deserve it or not. Kenneth Chapin, in his commentary on 1 Corinthians, shares this about the verb. It is not merely passive, passive meaning something that you receive. It is actively engaged in doing good to others. It's the picture of a person who spontaneously seeks the good for others and shows it with friendly acts. So it's something that we do. It's an action that we're involved in. So these two verbs, we see the perfect example of the kind of love that we've received from God. So understand this love is, the first thing we want to see is, you know, we know God is love. And these are two traits, active traits of his love seen towards us, and we're to turn around and to do that for other people. In 2002, a month after taking my first full-time job in ministry, I was a youth pastor, and we went to this program called Acquire the Fire. It's a Ron Luce program, and it had already been set up long before I got there. I'm not sure whether this church went before I got there. I'm seeing nodding yes. So it was very popular at the time. And there were some challenges there. The thing that I probably took most of a challenge from was their saying that, you know, that the younger people needed to come and show the older people how to worship because they don't know how to do it. I was like, well, that might not be the best way to word it. But there was this person who got up and he says, you know, here's what I'd like you to do. He says, I would like you to begin to think about the idea of doing random acts of kindness. And random act of kindness can be just anything. And he says, you know, as younger people, it will make a difference if you go out and do this. So we come back as a youth group, and we're thinking, you know, this sounds like a really good idea. The kids were really excited about it. So what we did was we said, we're going to start to implement a random act of kindness once a month for our youth group. We started off and it was October, so the leaves were coming down. So we said, okay, in this month, what we're going to do is we're going to find out some of the elderly, because it was in New Ipswich, had a lot of land. You had people who were still living in their homes but had trouble at that time. So we're like, okay, we're going to go through and we're going to rake their yards. That was how we started. That was going to be the first one. And we said, now here's the thing. When we're going to go through and we're going to do this, we're not going to receive any payment for it. And so we'd go through and we kind of found out through others how to go there. We went and we just did these people yards, and they're like, oh, this is so great. Can we support your youth group? We're like, no. We're just doing this on behalf of Jesus. So we just want you to know that Jesus loves you. The next month we went to a nursing home and we had a service and we just talked to people who were there. And so we sat down, we went through room to room when you could do that before Corona. And, you know, the young people who were there, the teens that were with me were like, wow, this is, because they were hearing stories and the the people who are in those nursing homes just beamed. They're like, oh, can we do this as our random act of kindness next month? It's like, you can go in and do it, absolutely, but that's not going to be our youth group one. The idea was we wanted to get them to look at different ideas. So we went to a hospital. We went to, we did a food pantry. We did a soup kitchen. So we did all of these different things. And each month we would look and we'd try to find a different area where we could go. And the idea was we're just going to go and we're going to try to make a difference for people and not accept anything in return. For these kids, the only thing that they got was we designed these t-shirts and it said RAK, Random Act of Kindness, RAK Crew, and we put the year on it, and they were hokey t-shirts that, you know, we bought like Hanes t-shirts, and then we got a thing, and I did a thing on the graphics on the printer, and then we, you know, you had to steam them on. The kids loved these though, and it was just their way. But so there were a lot of challenges that I faced in the 2 years that I was there, especially in my second year of ministry there. But one of the things that came out when they're all like, well, what have they done? They're like, what are you talking about? What have they done? You know, they've gone and they've impacted the community. There were people who actually said that the youth have done as much, if not more, than the church had done, because we were stepping out beyond ourselves. And that had nothing to do with me. As I said, this was an idea that came before I got there. It came, you know, from us being in this Acquire the Fire. It showed up. We just took it and ran with it. And it was wonderful. And the kids, it impacted, because they realized all of a sudden that they could make a difference. And you can making a difference doesn't mean that you need to financially help someone. Kindness isn't about just giving someone money. It can be helping them in situations where they may find themselves challenged. So, you know, going to people's homes and, you know, raking their lawns and helping out. I know we did a bit of that here for a while when we set up the adopt-a-block, and we go through the neighborhoods and one things that we did. And, you know, when we did it here, it was like 6 months in when people are like, why are you still doing this? You know, the press isn't following you. You know, it's not like the paper's doing reports. You know, it's like, we just want you guys to know we care about you. And there were some people who started coming to the church. We have some people still who are active in the church who came because we did neighborhood outreach. But we started with it, and we just said, we're not going to just go and preach Christ. We're going to show them that God loves them. We're going to, in a sense, show kindness to them. And eventually people ask, and there are people in the neighborhood, some who couldn't stand the church, who still don't believe in Jesus, but they're friendly with us, and we can talk, and they smile, and we can interact, you know. So, and others, we've just had opportunities to pray with people and to help them in different circumstances. These are acts of showing kindness. So, you know, as we look at this idea, this concept of love shows kindness, you know, we start with where God is with us. And, you know, depending on where you're at, that may be the place that we start. You know, I don't know. Do you, you know, if you're watching and you don't know that Jesus loves you, and you don't understand just how patient he is with you and how much kindness he's shown towards you, because we continue to disobey him and he continues to love us and to say, well, I've paid the price. All you need to do is take it and accept it. So the first piece is, you know, first to understand we can't pay God back. So acts of kindness, random acts of kindness, whatever you want to call them, are not ways that we pay back God. It actually has nothing to do with that, because the reality is there's no way we could ever repay God for all that he has done for us. There are ways that we get to pass his love along to others. So what does this look like? As I said, it kind of depends where you're at. If you don't know Jesus, I want you to know he loves you, and that his loving kindness has paid the price for your sins. And no matter how many sins there are, no matter how many mistakes you made, no matter how many challenges you've gone through, the reality is that God says, I paid the price. I paid it in full on the cross. So all you need to do is accept that. And you get a chance to see and to feel my loving kindness. For those who have accepted Christ's loving kindness, and that is what we've done if we've accepted Christ, right? He's shown his loving kindness towards us, his patience and his loving kindness. And then we turn around and we receive that and we become his children. And in that, now we get the opportunity to turn around and to show love to others, not human kind of love, which is often twisted, but we get to show it in the way that God intends us to show it to other people. Maybe it's helping someone with food who needs it. Now, many who know, who've been here, know that we don't typically give cash out as a policy, but we've been known to buy people food and buy people groceries and things like that, to help with bills when we're able to. But it can also be physically. We've had people that we barely know that have said, I'm moving, do you think you could help? And we've gone to help people move from one apartment to another or get them loaded into different places. We did quite a bit of that when we were up in through the neighborhood. There's people move in and out of Elm Street all the time. People tend not to stay here all too long for the most part. So that could be a way to do it. It could be taking the time to listen to someone who needs someone to talk to. Not to answer the problems and not to solve all their issues, but just to listen and to be compassionate and to love. And I'm sure there's all sorts of other ways that we can show God's kindness to others. So if you're willing to take the challenge, and the challenge really for us is to love as Jesus loves, then what we need to do is begin to think of how can I not only add to patience. So I want to try to continue with patience towards God and towards other people this week, but I want to add this issue of showing kindness to others. It could be someone that you know has kind of been hinting that they need help and no one's kind of stepping up. It could be a complete stranger, someone that you see on the side of the road that you just like, here, I want to bless you. If they ask you why, here's something that is a great way to answer. If someone asks you, why are you helping me? Well, you know what? Because Jesus helped me out. And I just want to share that with you. And I've said that often, and we have a pastor's discretionary fund, which is set up to help people who are in need. And so that's usually the first Sunday of the month. People who want to can give to the pastor's discretionary fund. And then as people come in, we say, well, if they ask someone in the parking lot, well, have them come and see me, and I can try to help them. And we take that fund, and when I give them anything from there, I say, I need you to know you want to receive this as coming from Christ, because that's really who it's coming from. The people have set up and have given, but we want you to know that this isn't about individuals and it's not about a church. This is about Christ caring about you and being there for you. And that should be our goal. So to love as Jesus loves is going to require for us to be patient, but it also requires us to show kindness, because that's what he did for us. Lord, we want to thank you for this day. And Lord, we live in a hostile world right now. And in the midst of this, we ask you, as Lord, as people seem to be fighting and arguing and just there's all sorts of hatred going on, Lord, we ask you to help us be people who love as you love. That not only will we be patient people, but Lord, that we would be people who show kindness to those around us. That you might be glorified, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Just stand and join us in singing Your Love, O Lord.
your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky.
Lord, we thank you for this day that you've given us, that we were able to be here, Lord, and just listen to your word. God, we pray for this country. We continue to pray and cry out to you, Lord, that this nation can turn back to you, God. We see how in Washington today, Lord, there was the National Day of Prayer, Lord, and people gathered just to cry out to you, Lord. And we continue to do so, Lord, because this nation needs you. We need you, Lord. It all starts with us, God. Change our hearts, Lord. Change our minds. Señor, te pedimos sobre esta nación, que hoy hubo Día Nacional de Oración en Washington, Padre. Te pedimos que esta nación vuelva a ti, Padre. Y que empiece con nosotros, Señor. Que tú vuelvas nuestros corazones y nuestra mente hacia ti, Padre. Porque solo en ti, Señor, vamos a encontrar salvación y liberación. God, it's only through you that we will find salvation and freedom. Lord, forgive us of all our sins, Lord. We repent of our ways. Pray this in your name. Amen.
To join us in this final song.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning up the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered on the ground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard, 'cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
Now may the grace, mercy, peace, and love of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, his Son, our Savior and Lord, and the blessed Holy Spirit be with each one of you today until Jesus Christ returns, and then forevermore. Amen.